Good evening and welcome to the March meeting of the Cape Elizabeth Planning Board. To begin the meeting, the first thing I would like to review is the minutes of our previous meeting of February 17th, 1997. Do any of the board members have any items from those minutes which they'd like to go over? Mr. Emery.
Mr. Chairman, page 6, the third paragraph, last sentence.
Yes.
It states, because they are not, this is in context to workshop meetings and public hearings, because they are not invited to speak should not be misunderstood, but it is not a public process and does not involve public input. I think that just needs some clarification. Workshop meetings are certainly public meetings, but it's not part of a formal public hearing process at that point.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And on page 8, third paragraph, again, this is in context to a paraphrasing of a comment of mine. It says, he said at some public hearings people have stood up and made wild, outrageous comments and got the press involved. I'd like a clarification that that's in reference to professional work outside the town. I'm not specifically stating that at Cape Elizabeth public hearings. I've been in other communities where people have gotten up and made very unsubstantiated comments. That's all.
Okay. Did anyone else notice anything in the minutes? If not, would anyone like to make a motion? A motion?
Move adoption of the minutes as presented, as amended. Sorry.
Second.
Okay. All those in favor, raise their right hand. The next item I would like to do is go over the correspondence which we have received in the past month. The first was a memorandum from the police chief regarding the proposed 911 ordinance amendment. The second was zoning news for February 1998. The third was a letter from M. Vetterline regarding the referendum. And the last was a memorandum from the State Planning Office regarding coastal needs. This evening, on our desks, we also have a few other memorandums, which I would like to add to this list. The first is a memorandum from Tom Emery regarding our planning board agenda and heights of buildings. The next was a memorandum from the Conservation Commission covering comments which they made at their March 17th meeting at their last meeting. The next is a memorandum from the Conservation Commission regarding their comments on the Riverside Memorial Cemetery plan. And the final memorandum is a memorandum to Maureen O'Meara from Phil McGoldrick, the fire chief of Cape Elizabeth, regarding the Sprague Estate Master Plan. Mr. Emery.
Mr. Chairman, in my memorandum, I have expressed the desire to perhaps take 10 minutes and make a few comments and bring the board up to date on some activities that involved the two of the committees that I'm serving on, the Town Farm Committee, mm-hmm. and also a follow-up regarding the Town Center report and Town Council meeting. Also, the fact that I'm going to have to recuse myself from the last three items under new business in this evening's agenda, and I would welcome the opportunity to leave before those first three items so that I can meet other schedules. If the board would like more clarification why I'm requesting this evening, I think I can make that clear based on the council comments the other evening.
Would anyone have any opinion to express one way or another on this? I think, Mr. Emery, in particular in regard to the fact that we won't be benefiting from your input on upcoming things, we won't be hearing from you for a little while, and the cogentness of the items outlined in your memo, I think it would be very good for us all to have those presented.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Chairman. I won't read the memo. That's available for anyone who would like to see what's in the memo, but I'll paraphrase it. It's several pages long. But the first item is an update on progress of the Town Farm Study Committee. I'm not sure with new members of the council, the Town Farm Study that deals with the former Poor Farm property off Spurwink Avenue has been received and accepted by the council, and the council has created a new subcommittee called the Technical Committee that's made up of three members, including myself, and we're now, with the help of Maureen, putting together or pulling together examples of easement language and zoning language that we will then send back to the council so that they can look at alternative ways of implementing preservation or protection of portions of the town farm property. Second issue is the issue of the town council public hearing that was held last, I believe that was Wednesday evening, March 11th, and I've subtitled that issue Intended versus Unintended Consequences. I brought the board that was that I presented at that council meeting, and that was a televised meeting, but I made it clear as part of the public hearing on the proposed referendum dealing with the height issues in the town center that I was speaking as a citizen of the town and as a member of the Town Center Studies Committee, not representing the opinion of the Planning Board. What has come out of that public hearing is the fact that the referendum will go to vote at a May meeting, and the council will look to the Planning Board and the Ordinance Committee to provide input prior to that meeting. So I guess this is an opportunity, given the rapid schedule, that we really can't afford to wait until the next workshop meeting. I just want to bring the board up on some of the issues. The issue that I specifically addressed was the issue of the impact of the proposed height limitation of 25 feet, and then the redefinition of height, building height. The diagram that's presented there, and as I outlined it at the meeting, the building on the left is a fairly classic 1960s two-story wood frame building with 8-foot ceilings at the tallest, 9-foot floor-to-floor height, and the buildings built back in the 60s in order to accommodate on structure and roofing often had very shallow roof slopes, 6 and 12. The dashed orange line at the top is the 35-foot height definition currently employed, or that's not the definition, that's a 35-foot height measured from the dashed green line, which I called average grade in that section. The solid red line is the maximum height of a building to the peak as defined or as recommended in the referendum language. And that's measured from the lowest point of the property. In the example I've shown here, I've assumed that there are two low points to present two alternatives in one diagram. The solid red line relates to the dashed green line as being an average grade. That would assume that you were putting a house on a flat site and you would need to raise the floor elevation from average grade about 3 feet in order to have clearance underneath the framing and also to have room left over to shed water away from the foundation. The point I made to the council is that the example on the left is a 26-foot wide, two-story wood frame house, similar to the one that I happen to own, not in the town center, but down in Brentwood. And I wanted to demonstrate to the council that the proposed language would make my house a non-conforming structure under the ordinance, and further pointed out that it just seemed unusual that in the town center where we're looking for commercial buildings and uses that even a small house such as that would already exceed the height limit. The dashed line further relates to the issue of a height definition, the dashed red line. That's 20-foot, 25-foot height measured from the lowest point of the property of the building location, and that assumes a daylight basement. The reality is in the town center, on both sides of Route 77, in many cases, we have land sloping away from the street, except where it's been artificially leveled. So the likelihood of finding land that's going to be flat is not really likely, so that in the extreme case, or not, and actually not the unusual case, where one's locating a building on a sloping site, again, as the ordinance requires, trying to keep it fairly near the road, actually within 35 feet of the road is required in the ordinance. The height of the building then, the 25-foot height, would be the dashed line. One would not be able to construct a two-story with a pitched roof. One would not be able to construct a two-story building with a pitched roof. On the example in the middle, I should go on a little bit. The example in the middle is a two-story frame dwelling of the 1980s, 1990s scale. Those typically have higher ceilings and they're a little bit wider, and the roof slope in that example is 10 and 12. Very typical of the houses you see in Stonegate and in other newer neighborhoods. The last example on the right is an example of a commercial building that might have a higher floor-to-floor height due to the need for ductwork and deeper structure for longer spans for open office space. I arbitrarily selected 12 feet floor-to-floor. That might be a little high. 11 feet might be appropriate. Some people might try to lower it, but in Class A office space, it's going to be somewhere around 11 feet, 10 feet, 12 feet. That example indicates on a sloping site, it would be very difficult to get much more than a single-story building, and what one would end up with in the town center would be, in a commercial use, would be a single-story building, flat roof, or with an extremely shallow roof. And if one wants to know what that looks like, then all one has to do is go around and look at the warehouse-type buildings that have very shallow roof slopes. Not to go on too much longer, but the issue I tried to present to the council was the fact that the town center ordinance was created and the language was drafted, not based strictly on space and bulk, but on a whole number of design criteria, that we want to relate to existing buildings in the town center, we want to fit the scale and the historic precedent in the town center. And although there are concerns about perhaps proposals before the board at this time about the mass of the building, the proposed language in the referendum would make it impossible to meet the design guidelines in the town center. And indirectly, that follows to the third point I wanted to make, and I just wanted to, for public disclosure, to let the board know that historically, we've had quite a few discussions about customer service and the issue of completeness regarding applications. And a concern that we've had is that we want applicants, once they've been informed that the application is complete, not to have to go back and make continuous changes because we continue to ask for this and that. On the other hand, we have an application completeness checklist that specifically lists items. Examples I can think of is that we may ask for, if you go down that checklist, there may be items that aren't specifically on that checklist. We might ask for additional planning work. We might ask for additional photography, other things. Having seen the issue of the referendum raised, and I'll use the term ugly head, I have concerns that the board now has to be, at least in my opinion, has to be very careful about when an application is complete and when it isn't complete. We had asked an applicant at workshop to prepare several things in preparation of getting the application complete. Those items were not prepared, but they weren't necessarily strictly part of the checklist, and a master plan is an item that easily comes to mind. Depending upon how this goes through referendum, if for any chance this were to pass referendum, then I would really be extremely careful to be sure that any application that's before the board, we go strictly by the checklist and get those items checked as complete and get the applicants before us as quickly as possible. Because there seems to be a concern here that the public isn't getting before the board quickly enough in the public process or the public hearing process. And if we alert an applicant to the issue that during workshop, we will be asking for items that aren't on the checklist, and they elect not to submit those at the checklist review period. I think it's still appropriate to deem the application complete, but then to continue to ask for those items after the application is complete, as long as the applicant has been put on notice. But what I state in my memo is I don't want either myself or the board to become an unwitting partner in tactics that are not part of the typical Cape Elizabeth regulatory review process, and certainly are not typical to what this board has tried to do in terms of customer service for the last at least 4 or 5 years that we've been on notice regarding customer service, and certainly for the last 8 years that I've been serving on the board. So I think that pretty much just brings you up to the date of up to speed with where I've been and what my thinking is, and why I will be taking a much closer look at the issues of whether it's on the list or not on the list in terms of completeness.
Thank you, Mr. Emery.
Thank you.
The next item on our agenda is an application which has been placed on consent agenda for the Murray change of use, a request by Gerald and Sharon Murray for an amendment to a previously approved site plan to change the use of the building located at 297R Ocean House Road from office to village retail, section 19-9-6, de minimis change to a site plan. This is something which, due to the circumstances of the application being one which technically falls under a change of use section in the zoning ordinance requiring site plan review, but the plan being essentially the same as one approved earlier by the board a few years ago, and one in which there will be no changes undertaken to the site. Given those two very relevant aspects of the application, this has been placed on our consent agenda. If anybody has any comments or any board members would like to discuss this or feel it needs to be looked at in more detail, I'd be happy to entertain any comments at this point. Mr. Parkhurst.
I'd like to make a motion.
Thank you.
A motion for the board to consider, be it ordered that the consent agenda be approved.
Second.
All those in favor, raise their right hand. Okay. Thank you very much. Now to move on to further business of the board, we have old business remaining from our last month's meeting, which was not completed. And this item is our discussion and ongoing review of the proposed addressing ordinance. We have a request by the Town Council to review a proposed addressing ordinance and an amendment to the subdivision ordinance related to addressing, section 19-10-3, public hearing. Just to maybe refresh everyone a little bit, perhaps Maureen could tell us what this is about and give us a recap a little bit. I don't think we need to.
Certainly. And I can see that the police chief has just walked in, so the board may want to be aware of that and use him as a resource if there's any questions. What I'm going to do just briefly is that the town has decided to move ahead with an enhanced E911 system, which will allow us to better respond to emergency calls. There's been a committee appointed, chaired by the police chief, also with the fire chief and the town assessor. And one of their first recommendations is for adoption of an addressing ordinance that would standardize street addresses and street numbers in the town. This was sent to the council. The council has asked the planning board to comment on it. One of the things we did change from the model ordinance that was sent by the state is instead of putting some of the language in the addressing ordinance, we instead avoided some repetition by adding an amendment to the subdivision ordinance, because it seemed that talking about addressing for new subdivisions was more appropriately located in the subdivision ordinance than in the addressing ordinance. So you do, you are holding a formal public hearing on the addressing, on the subdivision amendment tonight, and decided that you would also hold a public hearing on the addressing ordinance. What you have before you is a draft of the subdivision amendment, which you choose to send to the council tonight. Also attached is a draft memorandum, which is intended to summarize your comments about the addressing ordinance. So what you'll be doing after the public hearing is looking at both of those drafts, making sure that there are no changes that need to be made, and then you could potentially forward them to the council this evening. Any questions?
Well, just to recap a little bit, at last month's meeting, we had a little bit of discussion about the types of things that would be needing to happen under this proposed ordinance amendment, dealing with needing to have clear numberings of streets and streets which do not duplicate names of other streets in other parts of town. And the board thought that it would be a good idea for us to schedule a public hearing for tonight, so that anyone who had concerns about anything that any ideas which need to be brought to light as this process moved forward could have a chance to enter those into sort of the process that will happen as we move into this new new area of municipal services. That said, at this point in time, I'd like to open the public hearing. I guess I do that. That. If anyone in the audience would like to offer some comments on our proposed 911 system amendments, we'd be very eager to hear them. Don't everybody rush at once here. At any rate, anyone who does have thoughts about this can always jot a note or a memo to any of the folks in town or the planner, and we'd be very happy for anyone to do that. No one responding at this point, I'd like to close the public hearing. And at this time, the board will take a look at how we respond to our charge of reviewing these proposed amendments and what we do in terms of offering comment back to town council and recommendations. If anyone on the board has any comments regarding how we proceed at this point or items on the draft memorandum, now we would be a good time to go over those. Yes.
I have a question.
Yes, Ms. Masterson.
We have a draft memorandum which sort of embodies the our discussion on this addressing ordinance. Are we going to forward that on to the council?
If we agree that it is the proper course of action to take and that we agree with the ideas which we earlier drafted, there being no public comment or further input, I guess unless anybody has thought of something, a different idea or angle or something that they feel we've left out at this point, I think the thing for us to do at this point is to discuss a motion to forward it to council.
Well, if there isn't any further comment, I would like it to be ordered that the planning board forward the attached the comments embodied in our memorandum to the town council regarding the addressing ordinance.
Okay. Does anybody else feel that way? We can have that as a motion, I believe.
I'll second that.
Okay. Is there any discussion? Yes, Mr. Emery.
Mr. Chairman, item number six, street naming. I may be missing it elsewhere in the language, but I recall in Maureen's memo that there was a suggestion that we, or a discussion that we had regarding a suggestion that we have somebody from the Cape Elizabeth Historic Society involved on the naming committee, someone who could help with the historic, both the history of the town as well as designating historic names or appropriate names.
I'll accept that as an amendment to number six on our memorandum.
Mr. Parkhurst.
The last time that we dealt with this, I think I made a suggestion that the people that would be affected on private ways, what have you, should have a say in what the road renaming would be, as opposed to being encouraged to participate. It's their street. As long as the name doesn't conflict with something else in the town, I really think they should have a final say. I would like to have some something in number six changed to reflect that. The way it's worded right now, it just sounds like they're encouraged to, but not really either responsible or don't have the, can't think of the right word, don't have the right to participate, just encouraged.
Okay.
That may be included in item 10, Steve, or?
Well, the last sentence of item six and item 10 together speak to that issue. Do you feel that, I think maybe if we review the language, let's review the language of those and see.
I see number 10, and I had seen number 10 before, but it states, the Planning Board specifically recommends that section 22-3-1 be revised to explicitly provide opportunities for residents to participate in the address changing process. If I remember correctly, the Chief of Police is the one that has the final say. I really strongly feel if someone lives on a private way in this town, if they should have the right to pick the name, as long as it doesn't conflict with anything else, then that name should be the name.
I can add a sentence back to
that. And there may be something, you know, private ways in this town, we have no idea what the people themselves who live there call it, just out of an affectionate name or something, that has some historical merit to those particular people. And that should be the name that's used, if that's what they so wish.
Yes.
Maybe I will shed a little light on this, Mr. Chairman. The intention of that language in the draft is to allow me, state recommended that we have an addressing officer not to select the names, but to act as a mediator. You can imagine, and we've had some experiences in other parts of town where there have been new road names, where people are at an impasse as to what that name, what that road should be called. Believe me, the last thing I want to do is to select names of individual private ways. So it would be our intention as a committee and my intention as an addressing officer simply to act as a mediator in these cases. I think if the board wants to have somebody from the Historical Society work with us in terms of a mediation or a way to bring some question to closure as to what a street name should be, we'd certainly have no problem with that. But it's not the intent that I should be the one to select the actual name.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Mr. Chairman,
yes, Mr. Emery.
I support Mr. Parkhurst. I think what he's trying to get into the language, I think, is very appropriate. And I would support a specific reference that people who live on private streets, et cetera, assuming that there's, the name Parkhurst isn't about to be invoked as a private way in the town of Cape Elizabeth.
Don't think so.
I think Maureen has some, an overview, a little more information here.
I'd like to offer an additional sentence to number 10 for your consideration. Starting for private ways, the residents of that street shall be able to choose their name so long as the addressing coordinator determines that the selected name does not conflict with an existing name.
Sounds great. The reason why, I guess I need to explain this, I'm, as a lot of people probably know, I'm a real estate broker, and I have a piece of property for sale up in Freeport, and Freeport took it upon themselves to name private lanes, et cetera, without consulting the residents of the private lanes. Some of the names that they came up with are absolutely astounding. I mean, they are named after African birds, and it's totally inappropriate for the state of Maine. So that's my impetus for this.
Well, I think that, that's an excellent sort of clarification to how the process should work here. Are there any other thoughts? Let's see. We have a motion which has been seconded and now amended. So
there have been amendments proposed.
And we have proposed amendments. So I guess we have to
second the amendments.
Have somebody move to,
or the person making the amendment, the motion, could accept the amendments.
I accept the amendment.
Accept the amendment.
And I'll further move an amended version of the memorandum. And now I need a second.
Second.
Okay. Thank you. With these further clarifications, then, all of us in favor of adopting this motion, please raise your right hand. And it's unanimous. Thank you very much.
The motion only included the memo.
Okay. We need to discuss further then. Our adoption of the subdivision ordinance amendment and our recommendation on the adoption of the new ordinance subdivision ordinance amendment to town council also. Within the specific language of the subdivision ordinance itself, are there any comments?
Do we need to make another motion to include that?
Yes, these are two separate items.
Okay. Be it for the further order, the planning board for the, the planning board recommend the adoption of the attached subdivision ordinance amendment.
Okay. Do I hear a second?
Second.
Seconded. Any discussion of the language of the ordinance amendment at this point? All those in favor of the motion, raise your right hand. That's unanimous also. Thank you, board members. Moving on to new business, our first item of new business this evening is the 537 Shore Road site plan, a request by Liz Monahan and Kurt Nielsen for site plan review of a change of use from retail to personal services in the existing building located at 537 Shore Road, and this will be reviewed first under section 19-9, site plan completeness. And if the applicant could give us an overview of the proposed application?
Good evening, board members. My name is Elizabeth Monahan. This is my husband, Kurt Nielsen. We own the property located at 537 Shore Road. And I hope that all of you had an opportunity to drive by it, take a look at the location of the building. It's a building that many people native to Cape Elizabeth are familiar with. And it was previously known as the Basics Building. Prior to that, Pete Kelly's Fish and Farm Market and Cape Shore Variety. In reviewing the memo that I received, first of all, I want to apologize for the items that are missing, and I do take very seriously what Mr. Emery was stating about completeness of application. When we went to the workshop, many of the board members that were there indicated that they were familiar with the property. They realized that we were under the crunch of time, and my understanding was having the sewer and water indications that's required by the site plan was something that you could say it was okay that we didn't indicate on our site plan. Also, the zoning ordinance or the town building inspector indicated to me that the setbacks for our building, because it's a non-conforming, I mean, that building could never be built today. It's an existing building. We are not changing anything exterior to that building. The only thing that we are going to change to the exterior of the building, if you would consider that, is to improve the parking facility, meaning the paving and the drainage, as well as placing a sign on the property. And when it comes to the sign, my understanding was we only can have a sign of so big, so wide, so tall, and we were going to follow the ordinance of the zoning ordinance. So we're here today to ask you, please, to consider a change of use. It really came to our understanding that we needed to have this site plan review because we're changing from a retail use to a service use. And to keep it simple and then open it up to you to ask me any questions that you may have, this use, a service use, creates less traffic, less wear and tear on the actual building. It's a complement to our tenants that we have in the building. It's a much quieter type of business, and our goal is really to keep our tenants there and happy with each other. So we ask for you to consider us, and first of all, consider our application thorough enough, and secondly, to allow us to use this as a service-based use.
Thank you very much. At this point, what we customarily do is, before we actually sort of get into a review of any sort of specific proposed improvements, is we just sort of go over what we believe is whether or not the application is complete before we move on to actually doing a substantive review. So I guess at this point in time, I guess Maureen has done a checklist for us, and it would probably be a good idea if she just goes through a few of these and we can then discuss them.
And the board should be aware that when I make a checklist, I go through pretty much standard through the list, and if I know the board has said they were not willing to look at certain items, I've included them anyway, and it's up to you to decide what you want to include and exclude. But under number 7, the site plan regulations require that building setback information is dimensioned on the plan, and the plan is drawn to scale. You can throw a scale on it and figure out what the setbacks are, but the dimensions aren't there. The location of the sewer line has not been shown. The applicants aren't proposing to put in a new sewer line. They're just using the existing line. And the same thing with public water. There's no changes proposed there. And then on the sign, typically the board does get a sketch that is dimensioned, and the applicant has provided a sketch of the sign, just didn't have dimensions on it. I have checked the sign ordinance, and if we're talking about a projecting or a suspending sign, we're looking at a sign with a maximum sign area of 6 square feet per side. That's it.
Do any board members have any comments regarding completeness of the submitted application? Yes, Ms. Masterton.
According to the information that we have, there appears to be some trouble with the parking lot in terms of flooding, and that you are going to do some work on the drainage. Is that what I understand?
When it doesn't flood, it creates a rather large puddle in the middle of the parking lot. And from the beginning, we knew that we wanted to do something about that particular puddle. And we did have Damon and Malone, Steve Malone came over, and I said, Steve, what are we going to do here? How can we make this work? And he said, well, if we build up just a little bit here and move it so that it's towards the drainage that we show on the site plan, I believe that that would take care of it, and it wouldn't go out into the street, and it wouldn't go to the next door neighbors, but it would go directly to the catch basin, because it's a relatively small area when you look at the whole picture.
Okay.
It's smaller. I don't know. What'd you say?
I'd say about this size.
Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah.
Okay.
In terms of completeness, they did on the plan. It says shows drainage flow. So I think in terms of further discussion of how it happens, we should save that until we deem the application complete or incomplete. But we did notice on the plans that you showed the sort of arrow where the water would go. So I think for completeness, we have that one already shown at least. In terms of looking at other completion issues, was there anything else other board members noticed? Mr. Parkhurst.
I'd like to make a motion.
Yes, please.
Motion for the board to consider, be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application for Liz Monahan and Kurt Nielsen for site plan review of a change of use from retail to personal services on the first floor of the building located at 537 Shore Road be deemed complete. Second.
We have a motion and a second. Is there any discussion? Mr. Emery.
Mr. Chairman, I think for the record, to put it on the record, this is an unusual application. Because the building had burned and it was vacant for a year, the applicant was under the impression that they would just have to renovate the building and then could continue, after they purchased the building, could renovate it and continue business as usual. If this were an empty site and a new proposal before the board, certainly I think our completeness review would be different than it is this evening. But essentially, I think what we're looking at here is an applicant who's taking an opportunity to take a burned-out building and try to renovate it and make it an important part of the neighborhood as well as a viable tax property for the town of Cape Elizabeth. So I think the board is bending over backwards to help in that process this evening.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Are there any other comments by the board regarding the motion? Hearing no other comments, all those in favor of the motion, please raise your right hand. And it's unanimous. At this point, I guess what we would like to do is just sort of go over any specifics of the application, which we have questions about, and I guess if any board members have any questions, we would be able to go over those at this point also. Mr. Parker?
I'd like to make another motion.
Surely.
Findings of fact, number one, Liz Monahan and Kurt Nielsen are requesting a site plan review of a change of use from retail to personal services on the first floor of the building located at 537 Shore Road. Number two, the application was deemed complete at the March 17th, 1998 meeting. Number three, based on section 19-7-8 of the zoning ordinance, 12 parking spaces are required to meet parking demands of the building. Number four, one of the 13 parking spaces depicted on the site plan, parking space one, is located off the property in the Shore Road right-of-way. Number five, the applicant has identified a ponding problem in the center of the parking lot and proposes to correct it by connecting to a catch basin. The town engineer has noted that the flatness of the site may require a new catch basin to affect surface drainage. Number six, the application substantially complies with section 19-9, site plan review. Therefore, be it ordered that, based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of Liz Monahan and Kurt Nielsen for site plan review of a change of use from retail to personal services on the first floor of the building located at 537 Shore Road be approved subject to the following conditions. Number one, the parking space number one be eliminated, and two, that any improvements to the site will not direct additional runoff to the abutting properties, and number three, that the proposed signage be dimensioned in accordance with the sign ordinance.
Is there a second?
Mr. Chairperson, I'd like to second the motion, please.
Now, is there any discussion of the motion? Have you got a chance to go over the conditions of approval that we've been looking at, and do you have any specific ideas with respect to those areas that you'd like to?
The number one, because we met the minimum of 12 and we were showing 13, mm-hmm. I think even in Maureen's memo that she indicated, just we satisfy that end. We also were thinking that if we got to the point where our tenants in the commercial space and the tenants in the residential space really were kind of bumping into each other there, that we would expand the parking space into the back area near the shed, which is there's trees back here. This is where the catch basin is here. We could tar this back to here and add another two extra spaces. Actually, it would work out to be three or four spaces if I formally measure. So that's one of my answers to that. And also, we have a couple of extra spaces in the front of the building that I think for site plan review, I couldn't really use those, but they are there. And for the runoff, I believe that the person who is going to end up doing our tarring for us, he's going to be able to figure it out for us. He did a great job over at our house, which we have an incredible grade problem there, and he was able to pull the water away from our house. Mm-hmm. And the third will, between Kurt and myself and the new store owners potentially, mm-hmm. we'll come up with a good sign that will meet the ordinance of the 6 square feet.
Okay.
Just to ask a question, if we wanted to have a sign that goes on the building in the front of the building, if you look at the front of the building and you can see the there's a couple of columns there, they have the old style type of probably about 10 feet by 2 feet, mm-hmm. and have a nice formal sign going across there, maybe with no lighting. Is there an ordinance for that? Hmm. Any type of
Is it hanging off the building?
Excuse me?
Is it hanging off the building?
No.
It would be affixed to the wall?
It would be right on top of the front of the building.
You're basically limited by the sign ordinance. You might be going in a size that's more than what you're allowed.
Okay, so I'll just refer to that.
The only other thing I noticed, and I'm not sure whether this really needs to be clarified, but the ponding problem is going to be corrected by directing runoff to a catch basin as opposed to connecting it to a catch basin. I believe you're talking about in the paving process just sort of re-sloping so that the water goes to an existing catch basin, right? No actual piping connections.
That's our first step. Before that parking area got worn down, there wasn't any puddling problem, and I don't believe that there was any type of puddling or runoff either way. But Steve was saying that he's going to direct it towards there, and if that doesn't work, then we'd go as far as connecting a.
Okay. Well, our item of our finding of fact number 5 used the word connecting, which I think might be better changed to directing.
Directing.
Instead of connecting in that case. I would like to offer as an amendment to the motion that in finding of fact item number 5, the word connecting be deleted and the words directing runoff be added.
Could it possibly be connecting slash, directing slash connecting if directing doesn't work?
Because we may have to.
That would be fine with me if you want. Mm-hmm. So if you do find you need to install a second catch basin, you'd be able to do that. Yeah, that would be fine.
I have no objections to the amendment.
Okay. Okay, we have a amended motion at this point in time. Mr. Emery?
Yes, just to elaborate on that a little bit, the town engineer's comment was that if the water cannot be sloped in that direction because the catch basin is higher than the low point in the parking lot, they may have to put in an inlet or a pipe. I can't get my hands on his comment. The other possibility is that they could lower the rim of the catch basin and try to make up the difference that way. So certainly mm-hmm. directing or piping, either one would be appropriate.
Well, at this point in time, we have a motion, a second, an amendment, and an acceptance of the amendment. Mr. Emery?
Once again, for the public record, is it clear on the public record that this building has come to the planning board having received a building permit and having been fully renovated?
I think that's something that's definitely worth entering into our discussions tonight. It's something we've all been taking for granted because all the photographs we have are of a fully completed, renovated building, which now needs just site plan approval to actually be put into use. And that is what we're...
And typically they would get a site plan permit before they started renovation of the building. Is that correct?
In this case, the applicant renovated the building with the expectation that they would get new tenants that were in the same use category as the previous tenants. And it was the appeal to get tenants in a different use category. They're originally in a village and a retail category. Now they're in a personal services shop. And that's what's really pushing them into the site plan. The current building inspector said that if they were willing to install something still in the retail category, he would not have required site plan review.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. Any other items to entertain at this point with regards to the application? Hearing none, all those in favor of the motion, please raise your right hand. And it's a unanimous approval. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for your
time. Good luck.
I have to do it formally.
The next item on the agenda is the Riverside Memorial Cemetery Site Plan, a request by the trustees of Riverside Memorial Cemetery to expand the cemetery located at the corner of Bowery Beach Road and Spurwink Avenue, under Section 19-9, first of all, site plan completeness.
Thank you very much.
Mr. Chairman, excuse me.
Yes, Mr. Emery.
I beg the board's indulgence, I must recuse myself, as I said earlier, on this item and the next two items, so I would like to take my leave, if I may.
Is that okay with other board members? Do we let him go? Yes, Mr. Emery, we're glad.
Thank you. I support your motion to adjourn when and if it takes place.
Please tell us something about the project.
Thank you. Chairman Wilcox, members of the planning board, my name is Deborah Lane. I'm the town clerk in Cape Elizabeth and your administrative assistant. Joining me this evening are members of the Riverside trustees, the chairman, Milton Hollowell, and member Wayne Brooking. My comments will be very brief this evening, as Steve Moore will be presenting the application on behalf of the town. We're very fortunate that once again Steve Moore and his firm is representing the Riverside trustees. In 1993, the Riverside trustees had a master plan developed for the cemetery. This document has been used as a guide as we use this information to build on the expansion plan that you see before you this evening. The trustees really would like to ensure the planning board, as well as the members of the public, that they have carefully examined the cemetery in terms of lot sales, number of burials, and other factors which influence the demand on the cemetery, and that the thought process for the expansion has not been taken lightly. We have walked very carefully through this process, and in the interest of maintaining really the basic operation of the cemetery as it is now. The trustees and Steve Moore and his firm understand the unique and sensitive nature of the service that we provide at Riverside. We believe this application is complete and ready for your action. Myself and the trustees would like to thank Steve and Tanya for their work in representing the town for this application. And with that, I would like to thank the planning board for your consideration this evening, and now I will turn it over to Steve.
Thank you, Deb. Good evening, board members. As Deborah has so graciously said, Steve Moore from Mount Sarah and I'm just going to turn this board so the public has the advantage of seeing these illustrations, as well as members of the planning board. As Deb has said, we started this process back in 1993, looking at, pardon me.
Now, Mr. Moore, could we just take a second? Can members of the board see the display?
Yeah, I have, display? I have my driving glasses. Thank you.
I'm the only one, I think, who can't see it, but that...
Are we in trouble with the chair? Can you see the board?
Can't see through the podium.
The chair can't see the board.
Podium.
That's very bad.
Don't do that. I got it.
That's okay. Very good. Thank you.
We began this process in 1993 in looking at the master plan and moved carefully in that master planning process to develop an expansion plan that both respected what the environment was out there, considered the town ordinance, and most importantly, in our opinion, reflected the character of the existing cemetery and the care that was taken by Myron Lamb when he designed the cemetery in 52. So we looked at those considerations and brought forward the master plan that passed through the town in council for an endorsement from the council for approval of the master plan. And we're now back before you seeking site plan approval, because the trustees wish to move forward with the plan and actually implement this next phase of the plan. The cemetery itself is 27 acres. And the way this began was that Mr. Jordan dedicated some land to the town, which added some acreage to the original Spurwink Church and Cemetery. And when that land was dedicated to the town, I think in 1940, it pushed the acreage up to the 27 acres that the town has now. When the original cemetery was developed on a 6-acre parcel. So the land that is in the existing cemetery that you see now, that is over by the Spurwink Church here, which is shown in the light beige color, and the white area off the side, that is 6 acres of existing cemetery plots. And there are something a little more than 2,500 plots in that area. The new expansion, which is shaded in green on this plan, adds just a little over 3 acres to the cemetery developed area. And what we're proposing to do is add just a little over 1,800 additional plots into the cemetery, roughly 750 of which are cremains plots, they're 4x4, and the balance of them are full-size interment plots. So we're looking at the 3 acres providing enough build-out, if I can call it that, for about 20 to 30 years in terms of the current rate of interment that is happening at the cemetery. And when we set about looking this, we did not set a benchmark for a time and then build the plots out to it. What we looked at was the character, or were the character defining features of that site, and then arrived at a plot count that preserved the character and gave a fairly good saturation for plots, but also looked at the interment rate for that time period. In terms of some of the hard sort of facts and technical information, as we set forth in the exhibits that we presented to you in the submission, we looked carefully at the layout and worked with the layout to adapt it to the terrain out there. And we also worked with that in terms of preserving several mature trees. We felt that it was essential to keep some of the large oak trees. There's some 14-inch caliber oak trees and some large maple trees that we felt were very important to create a sense of permanence to the new cemetery expansion. Our concern was that if we simply cut the area of all the trees, it would appear to be just too barren, a 3-acre plot. The other piece that we considered in looking at the expansion was the existing Veterans Memorial. And that is the small grassy area that is down on the current end, on the current west end of the cemetery. And we felt that needed to be celebrated a little bit more and recognized as more of a memorial to the veterans, for a place for them to go and have various ceremonies. So again, on the plan, what we've done on the site plan is we've preserved the Veterans Memorial and enhance that, and in addition, worked with the existing trees to keep them in a drift throughout the new expansion so they're not just clustered in one area. The enlarged site plan that you see here is the same site plan that is contained in the planning board submission. And as you can see from the road layout, what we've done is we've taken the 1,800 feet of new road and shifted it and moved it so it works on two basic patterns, an upper loop and a lower loop, that connect back at the Veterans Cemetery. So we're not disturbing the existing roadway pattern, except for the one existing road that is over on the extreme right-hand or easterly side by the Veterans Cemetery. I didn't do that. And we've pushed that over again to define the Veterans Cemetery a little bit more, but also to allow this plot to be developed in a way that makes sense from a circulation standpoint. So we've included that in there. In terms of the layout, the plots are all laid out in a manner that allows good egress and access from the backhoes and from excavation. We've obviously talked with Public Works, with Bob Malley, and with the people who are doing the interment, so we know what that layout needs to be from a functional standpoint. And we're also looking at the use of small retaining walls in this area, both to define that Veterans Memorial, but also, as you see on the plans, to protect the routes where we're coming within about 30 feet with a couple of our roadways. In terms of the drainage, we did look at the existing drainage system, and we've been very careful to model the new cemetery expansion on the existing roadway pattern. So what you're going to see when this gets built is the same type of gravel road at a 14-foot width and very shallow side swales. The one thing we've done on this that's a little different than the existing cemetery is in the side swales, we've run a 6-inch perforated underdrain wrapped in stone so that it will always be dry in those side swale areas, so that when you're passing from the road into the burial sites, you're not going down through a deep dip in a wet area, but rather going through a gentle dip that at the most is about 8 inches deep, and it'll be dry because there's a stone bed and pipe in that. Those underdrains are then connected into a series of surface inlets or catch basins that tie out through a piping system and drop down and drop the water into level lip spreaders. The drainage pattern basically holds off on this northwest corner and then over on the northeast corner. And when we're done constructing this, what we're going to end up with is about a half an acre of new impervious area, new gravel, that is different than the existing cover of trees. What we've done in looking at the stormwater flows is shape and direct those flows into a closed system, into the pipe system. And when it comes out of the pipe, we're basically dropping it into a long, narrow trench that will fill up and then allow the water, the stormwater, to spill out over about a 30 or 40 foot length in a level sheet. So we've taken a concentrated flow and spread it into a sheet flow. When the stormwater calculations were run by the civil engineer, there was a fairly minor increase in the actual flows as they exited the pipe and entered into the buffer area that is down gradient at the cemetery. And what we did there is by dumping it through the level lip spreader and into the 250-foot buffer, our calculations show that that effect and change in that terrain was not sufficient enough to cause any problem in terms of erosion or groundwater saturation. And all of that information was contained in the report prepared by land use consultants, with which I believe the town engineer concurred, Steve Harding concurred with the findings. So we're not proposing detention on the site, but rather because of the low increase and because of the position in the watershed and because of the use of the level lip spreader, we're allowing the flows to go and spread into the wooded buffer area. In looking at the traffic situation and the circulation system, we did have Bill Bray, a traffic engineer, work with us on the intersections and internal layout, and then Bill also conducted the traffic study that was contained in your package. And essentially what Bill's findings were, that there isn't a traffic issue out here with respect to peak loading or peak hour loading, which you see on a lot of the projects right in town, that there really is a barely measurable increase in traffic on Route 77. I think it was 0.5% of a change in the traffic flow. And that there aren't any correctable, identifiable traffic accident problems within this road section. The majority of the accidents, if you read that report carefully, are deer to vehicle impacts, which is not considered by MDOT a correctable problem. The one thing that Bill Bray did pick up is that as you come out of the existing entranceway, which we're continuing to use, shown at the bottom of that drawing, the sight distance to the right, that is the sight distance looking to Scarborough, is fine. That exceeds the required sight distance. But the sight distance to the left is 330 feet, which is 70 feet less than what is required. And what Bill had recommended when we went out there was to simply push back the existing wall. The wall, as you may remember if you've been out there, comes down along Route 77 to a point. And then when the wall was extended, it was bent sharply and continued down to the new throat. And you can actually see the change in stonework if you've been out there. It's an older dry-laid stone with rounded, almost field-collected cobbles, and then it breaks and turns to more angular pieces that appear to us to be more of the stone that's come out of Murray's Pit rather than the field-collected stone that's in the rest of the wall. We have indicated on our site plan a 120-foot length of wall that needs to be set back 5 feet at the apex, at the high point, to achieve that improved sight distance. And we know from looking at that in the field that that will achieve the required sight distance of about 410, and what's required under the speeds out there is approximately 400 feet. So we know through the work that Bill Bray did in his traffic study that we can accommodate the traffic onto Route 77. I think the last couple of issues to talk about are the use of water and electric and lighting and those other things which you'd normally see on a site plan, which really aren't an issue out here. We are not proposing to light any of this facility. We're not proposing to extend electrical service down into this area. We are going to run seasonal water down in the area to allow the caretakers to continue to water and take care of the lower plots. And we've shown a detail in there that includes a freestanding stone post with the water line strapped to it. And it will be a seasonal service as it is now. So we'll use PVC pipe buried shallow, and then that system will be pressure evacuated during the fall so that it can be a shallow bury system. We've included in the package a couple of pieces of information about the site, both soils, topo, the boundary, to meet your completeness requirements. And we've included the plant list and the planting plan, as well as a sketch of the small building. One of the problems out here is that the little building that's out there doesn't really meet the functional needs of the caretaker. So we're proposing to build a new 24 by 16 building down in one of the lower portions of the site, out of sight. And as shown in attachment 6, what that is a small gable-roofed building that is about 14 and a half feet high and has double board doors on the north end to allow access in and out and internal storage. Right now, a lot of that storage takes place externally. We're trying to get all that trash and debris inside, and then that will periodically be taken down to the transfer station. I think the last thing, just to close with, in terms of public information, is that from a construction standpoint, what the trustees want to do is get this out for construction bidding and to build all of the roads and get all of the drainage system and the infrastructure put in place so that, excuse me, they have a complete seeded, loamed, and graded area. The lower area to the extreme west, or to my left or your left on that site plan, probably won't have sufficient fill from the material generated on site to get all the grade in this area pulled up to its final finished grade. We have about 2 feet of fill going in there. But the vision of that is that over time, as the plots are dug out, they need a place to put that surplus soil. So that's going to become that permanent fill zone. So in fact, we've got a small detail for a silt fence and a stone check dam to allow that ongoing erosion control to take place in that fill area. So gradually, as that is filled, it'll be loamed and seeded and created, but it gives us that location for overflow over the time. With respect to that, the stone wall and the additional plantings will be put in over time as sections are open. Now, the trustees are not planning to simply open this and have 1,810 plots available. It'll be open in small segments exactly the way that the cemetery is now. And the new expansion will operate under the same rules, which we included for you in your packets, that the existing cemetery operates with now. I think, in summary, as Deb has said, we've gone real slowly to really study the issues and make sure that every step was correct. The completeness application, we went through very, very thoroughly and tried to give you everything you needed to understand what was proposed, but also show how we are addressing the ordinance. There are a couple things that have been picked up by Mr. Harding and also by Maureen, and I'll just address those very quickly. Maureen and I chatted today about tree preservation. We noted on the plans for the tree preservation area, but we haven't actually stated with any great specificity or in detail how we're going to affect that tree preservation. So we do need to incorporate the tree preservation notes on the plan. We have those, they're in the technical spec, but they're not actually on the drawing. Likewise, with the erosion control information that you saw in your full submission in the 8.5 by 11, Mr. Harding has asked that that would go on the plans. That is something we're going to do. We just simply had it in the package for you, and we'll include that in the final construction documents. And likewise, with Mr. Harding's request for a few additional dimensions on the stone wall base, on the strapping details for the post and on the underdrain detail. Steve's asked for a few additional dimensions on those for construction. And I think he's right on with those comments, and we obviously will include those. There was a request from Bob Malley to pave both throats on the plan, both the existing throat off of Spurwink and the existing throat on the east side of the cemetery. And we will do that. I've spoken to Deb about that, and we have the budget to do that, and we will, in fact, include that paving on the plan. The one thing that we would like to see on there is the use of recycled paving put in place so it doesn't have the appearance of brand new asphalt and blacktop just stretching into the cemetery. We'd like to look at either using commercial paving or Blue Rock's recycled mix, which, for those of you who don't know that, it's the reclaimed paving that comes out of ground up bituminous that's then remixed, heated, a cut asphalt bituminous added to that, and then it's respread. So it has the appearance of old macadam-type tar roads, which gets both the stability that Bob was looking for, but also some of the appearance characteristics that we care about. Last comment, I promise. We've included in our appendix responses to both your standards and your completeness. They're included in the package, really for the board's ease of reference to understand how we've met the criteria that you have to examine the site plan. So with that, I'll turn it back to the board and make myself available to answer questions.
Thank you very much, Mr. Moore.
Thank you.
Typically, the first thing we do for an application for site plan review such as this is we review completeness. The complete site plan review submission checklist has already been filled in by Maureen. So I guess if Maureen, if you could kind of just sort of present the status of that at this point, that would be helpful.
Certainly. I just used the checklist and the ordinance under site plan review, and there's nothing incomplete at this that I can see. The applicant is not proposing any sanitary waste disposal systems, any lighting, or any new signage, so those are considered not applicable.
Mr. Parkhurst.
I'd like to make a motion. Motion for the board to consider. Be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of the trustees of Riverside Memorial Cemetery for site plan review of expansion of the Riverside Memorial Cemetery located off Bowery Beach Road be deemed complete.
Thank you. Do I hear a second?
Second the motion.
Is there any further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor of the motion, please raise your right hand. It is unanimous. We now have a complete application. At this point in time, what we probably should take a look at doing is starting some discussion about quantitative and qualitative aspects of the application in terms of how it appears to us. Does anybody have any comments to offer on the project itself? Mr. Parkhurst.
I think it was on the podium tonight, maybe it was in the packet, I'm not sure which, now that there's so many papers up here. The Conservation Commission has reviewed the plan and would like the location of the Spurwink pedestrian trail added to the plan. I'm not sure if I really know what this means. Could you enlighten us a little bit?
Sure.
Okay.
The Conservation Commission met last Thursday, and they always review everything the Planning Board gets. And actually, I think a member of the Conservation Commission is out in the audience, but who might want to step forward at any time. But my understanding is that the Conservation Commission looked at the plan, and they thought it would be useful for them to have the pedestrian trail located on the plan. And John.
Members of the board, my name is John Green. I'm a member of the Conservation Commission. We did review the application last Thursday. Over the course of the last year and a half, we had a Boy Scout working to obtain his Eagle Scout badge, I guess, working on a trail system that would connect the Poor Farm to the bridge at the Spurwink River. And it passed, this trail passes through the cemetery land. And we've gone out there and started building a bridge across a portion of some of this trail to access the cemetery property. And what we would like to see is this trail put on the plan so that it more or less becomes a permanent fixture on the plan or on the, in the cemetery, and that we can continue to publicize and include this in our Greenbelt trail system in town. I don't know if there are any specific questions. Essentially, we would just like to at least see it designated on the plan. We'd be happy to work with Steve to locate it, and if in the final submission it was shown on the plan, that would be fine by us.
Mr. Parkhurst.
So the trail does not exist as of yet, only a portion of it exists?
The trail does exist now. It probably could use a little work. The scout that was working on it did quite a good job in bringing back some of the old trails in that area through an old orchard on the cemetery property. And it's a nice connection from the river near the church there all the way over to the Poor Farm. So I think it's a quite a nice trail to have in town.
Ms. Masterson.
Could you point out on the map there just where that trail goes?
I'm not sure which map here.
Well, the one that's the one that's on the easel is, will do.
Map where the bridge is. There we go.
I think that's easier, John, to work from.
The trail runs from approximately just up the hill from the bridge, down along the marsh margin, and then through the existing woods here. There's an old orchard in this woods here, and it runs right through the middle of the old orchard. It runs down along the margin of the marsh where it is exposed, where you can look out across the marsh. It's down over the embankment, enters the woods here. And actually, there's a very nice trail that skirts the uplands along the marsh and almost all the way back to Spurlink Avenue. Where it crosses over to the Barber property, where there is a town easement across that property. And then that, in turn, works its way over to the town Poor Farm.
Thank you.
Is it in the wetland buffer as it passes near the expanded cemetery?
I believe the whole length of the trail on the cemetery property is probably in the buffer zone, in the wetland buffer, yes.
Okay.
Is this trail something that's going to be publicized, or is it just going to be kept very, very low key?
Well, we hope for some of these trails that it will be publicized within the town so that we can get the townsfolk to utilize it. But I can't see where it would be the type of trail utilized by many other people other than local residents or people visiting or parking at the Poor Farm area utilizing that trail.
Would it be maintained by the cemetery or commission or?
Well, the commission through the whole town is working towards producing a maybe a trail association. Right now, members of the commission are myself and others are the only ones out maintaining trails at this point in time. So we are looking to put together some sort of trail group in town to help maintain these trails. At this point in time, there is only a few volunteers that have stepped forward to help.
Thank you very much. Ms. Masterson.
Well, I guess the question remains, how does the applicant, how do the trustees feel about putting the the trail on their map of the cemetery.
Thank you. I did not know until just now that that was a request. I can tell you that when the Eagle Scout or the Boy Scout worked on the trail, I don't know when it was, John, last year or so, we were invited, the cemetery trustees and myself did go for a walk. It was, you know, like you say, down in the buffer zone, and that did not seem to be a problem at all. I think we talked about a concern about parking, whether or not there'd be parking in the cemetery. That was a question that came up. We were told that they did not see that parking would be advertised as such in the cemetery, so we were, you know, comfortable with that. The current trustees have not discussed it. We have two new members. I think one current member was a board member at the time that we went on the site walk, so we have not discussed it as it relates to going on to the plan. But at that time, we didn't see any problem with it. As I see, the parking issue was addressed, and it, you know, wasn't going to be a problem. Jack Roberts also joined us on that walk, so. So to answer your question, the current trustees have not discussed it. The previous trustees, we didn't have a problem with the trail as such, but we have not talked about it in the context of being on the actual plan.
May I ask another question of anybody? Do we have a map of the trail system in Cape Elizabeth? The green belt, et cetera, we do in the comprehensive plan, don't we?
No, we don't.
We don't?
Not an accurate map, no. We have a conceptual green belt map.
Okay.
It shows a concept of where green belt trails should be. A map that you can hand to someone that says you can walk here legally, we do not have, except for the trail that goes to Great Pond.
Okay.
My only caveat to the board, I discussed this briefly with Deb, was that simply showing that on the plan, showing the trail on the plan is fine, but I would want to footnote that the permits would be by the Conservation Commission and not the cemetery trustees. And I know I'm smiling, but in that, I believe working in that area, in that buffer zone, a permit is required from the codes officer for clearing and cutting of the trail. That would be my only comment to the board.
In terms of further evaluating the application, there are a couple of things that we do from time to time, and I was wondering if any board members had any feelings about the ideas of sort of physically inspecting or having a site walk to sort of take a look at the site in the field, or if people are familiar. Board members are familiar with the site already.
I have no objection to a site walk, although I've been in the cemetery a number of times.
Yeah. I think this seems to be
I am familiar with the cemetery, but I must say I'm sort of perplexed by this request to put the trail on the working plan for expansion of the cemetery. I do wish we had a trail map in town, because these trails are hard to find. And I'm not sure that that expanded cemetery map is the place to put that trail. I'm just ambivalent about it.
Chairman, appears to me that the first primary use would be the cemetery, and that the trail system would be subordinate to that. We can all imagine an interment with people marching by on a trail. I don't think that's going to work too well. It's got to obviously be some
some space barriers there between, we, as Ms. Masterson points out, we don't have any accurate map of the trails, what's being proposed here. It seems to me that we can go ahead with the what's before us, that is the enlargement of the cemetery without necessarily adopting anything with the trails, and leave that to the cemetery and the trustees to work on. But I don't know that we have to do anything on it, do we?
To the extent that there may be an agreement between the cemetery trustees and the Conservation Commission about the role of a trail on the site, I can see where this would be a good opportunity for all parties, given the fact that we don't have an overall actual trail plan, to have at least a record of any agreement on the trail, sort of at using this project as a means of doing it. However, I would agree completely that this is something that really should be considered by the cemetery trustees. Has there been a request, a sort of a formal request to the trustees at this point?
Not recently, no. As I said, a year or so ago, we were invited on a walk. We went, on that walk. There was no discussion at that time, to my recollection, that anything formal will be coming to the trustees in terms of putting it on, our plan for our future expansions. It was more of a, getting to know what they were talking about with the trail and this project that the Eagle Scout had. Mm-hmm. And again, we talked about parking issues, and they said, people would start to use it, but nothing as formal as this, I guess. And I guess I would hate to see that our application be held up or what have you because of it. That's not to say that a dialogue will not come before the trustees with the Conservation Commission, and they could entertain whatever, the commission could entertain from the trustees whatever it is, what kind of dialogue they want. Certainly we'd invite that. But to, if you will, hold up the application, I question the appropriateness of that for this matter.
Yeah. Okay, thank you. Mr. Parkhurst.
It seems to me if the trail is there already, it's a feature of the piece of land that we're considering. And if it's there, I don't think anyone's advocating any parking in the cemetery or anything like that. It's just simply put it on the map. So it's there. It has been depicted. This is one section of the town that has been mapped, and the trail's there. We're not advocating any use by anyone. It's just simply there. That's all. As I said, it's a feature of the land, so I don't see the harm one way or the other. I don't think it either should hold up the application or the cemetery trustees, but it seems to make sense just to depict it on the plan.
Is it, in fact, already cut completely? Is the trail actually there?
I've walked
that. It's a proposed trail.
John, I have to say, when I walked it, I thought it was a deer trace. I thought it was a deer trace down on that lower piece. Except for the evidence where there's been some low cutting, I figured it was a deer trail that the kids had gone in and lopped off the young growth in. So, John, my Eagle Scout project was sorting books in the library. So I didn't have the advantage of trails. It wasn't that clear to me in terms of walking that trail. And it does meander. I mean, the trail that I've seen really comes down that lower end and angles just at the low side of that orchard that John was talking about. And it is outside the expansion zone. It falls outside of the area that we're looking at developing for the project that's before you.
Does anybody else on the board have any comments on the trail? Sure, go ahead. No?
I would just concur with Steve's comments.
Yeah.
I don't think it should hold the project up or the application at this point.
I think it, at this point, is depicting it on the plan as existing a possibility. You mentioned if it needed permits, it would not go in your direction. But on the other hand, I would expect if it needed permits, that would denote some type of actual construction activity, like building bridges or widening trails or things like that. And I would expect that to come to somebody's attention and not just...
I think, again, the issue of showing that as the existing cut trail, that's certainly something we can put on there. But I think creating it as a part of the green belt and then the attendant use or parking or permits or whatever runs with that, I think is something that the trustees really need to mm-hmm. to evaluate and to go through the dialogue that Deb mentioned. But from an existing feature standpoint, we know enough from the traverse and the site walk we have out there from surveying that we could depict that very readily on the plan and show that as that existing cut trail. John, was I correct in that characterization? It's a fairly narrow trace that just has a very shallow 2 foot, 3 foot wide compacted area.
Mm-hmm. Well, would depiction of it with language that it's an unimproved trail or something which denoted the fact that it was not something which was being improved or its improvement was being reviewed or approved by either the cemetery trustees or by the planning board at this point in time, is that something that
I don't see that as an issue because it's one town agency dealing with another town agency about use of town land.
Okay.
So I think in terms of showing it that as an existing feature, as long as both the Conservation Commission realizes and the town realizes and this board realizes that it's something that we're showing as an existing condition.
Right.
I'm looking to the trustees as an issue. I think that's, it exists, it's cut, so we could certainly show that. As Deb said, I'll just echo what I think the trustees' real interest is they have the reserve account built up to the point where they really want to move forward with the project. And I think this, to see the trail in any way impact that ability to move on would really be a shame with the work that's gone into place to date.
Okay. Another item which I would like to offer for our consideration is the need for, or the lack of need for, this application to receive a public hearing. Do any board members have any opinions on?
To the chair, if I might, just for a minute.
Yes.
Forgive the board members, please forgive me for telling you what you already know, but this did go to the zoning board in January. We are a conditional use in the residential A zoning district. So in order to expand the cemetery, we had to go to the zoning board to get a conditional use permit. And we did have a public hearing with the Zoning Board of Appeals on January 27th. I believe there were 34 notices sent out. We have actually 5 immediate abutters, but we notified in the larger radius. No one came to that public hearing. And we have been before council before going to zoning board for their review of our current plan. So we have had some public input and hearing. So I just offer that by way of an indication that the plan has had public review and comment period. Thank you.
Okay. The public hearing issue is one with which we have been focusing a lot of our attention on recently. However, most of our projects are not, the applications which come before us are not as well known and already as well presented to the public as this one probably has been. So I'd be interested in any leanings or feelings.
I think we should. If there's already been one public hearing, I really don't think that we should hold this project up for a public hearing. And certainly, the issue of, I certainly didn't intend, in my ambivalence, to hold up this program because of the trail on the map. I certainly wouldn't want to hold the program up for that. I personally don't see a need for a public hearing.
Mr. Moore, could you tell us a little bit about your timing plans in terms of when you would actually want to have construction begin?
Yes, at the last meeting with the trustees, when we reviewed the plans and talked about a time schedule, what we had talked about was going out to bid this month. We had wanted to issue the drawings for bidding in the middle of March so that we could at least pick up some advantage from the couple of local contractors to get in line for work. So we're looking at a rather select bid list and having this looked at so we can have some numbers back in hand to the trustees in April, so a decision could be made and then the clearing and cutting could begin. So it really was the keen interest of the trustees to get the cutting started this spring and get the road construction done early in the summer so we have a good season to get the grass catch in place and mown a few times before September. So that was our wish and our goal back when we looked at this after the council had reviewed it, but before coming to the workshop, I think, with you in February, I think we came to the planning board. So that's the intent. What really is pushing that is the fact that there's a tremendous amount of work right now out being bid by contractors, and our interest, not only from a price standpoint, but a timing standpoint, was to move as quickly as we could now this spring. So that's really our time schedule.
Mm-hmm. Okay, I guess in terms of Mr. Parker's, go ahead.
Just going along with the whether or not we need to have a public hearing, there has been one held, it was not attended. I frankly think if we have one, it probably will not be attended either. So I don't really see a need for a public mm-hmm. hearing next month here.
Okay, I have a question for Maureen. I noticed that part of the plan has very diligently avoided any impact into the RP1 buffer. Anything that had to do with a resource protection permit would obviously have a required public hearing, but under normal site plan review, sometimes we have public hearings and sometimes we don't, I believe.
Right, under the site plan regulations, you have the option to schedule a public hearing, but you're not required to. You used to be required to hold a public hearing anytime you needed a wetlands permit. However, with the new ordinance, we changed that so that you now have the same flexibility under resource protection permits as you have with site plan. So you do not have to hold a public hearing. You do not have to hold a site walk. You can consider approval this evening if that's your choice.
Okay. Mr. Parkhurst.
Well, in that case,
go ahead.
May I make a motion? Motion for the board to consider, be it ordered that, based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of the trustees of Riverside Memorial Cemetery for a site plan review of the expansion of Riverside Memorial Cemetery located off Bowery Beach Road be approved.
Mm-hmm. Second.
Any further discussion? No? I think that's because we had such a thorough presentation on this application. All board members in favor of approval, raise your right hand. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. only 10 minutes behind schedule. Stare people.
Agenda is the Sprague Family Boardwalk, a request by the Sprague Corporation for a resource protection permit to construct a boardwalk located west of Breakwater Farm near the causeway to Richmond Island, section 19-8-3, resource protection completeness. And if the applicant can come to the podium and give us a summary of the proposed application.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. My name is Terry DeWan. I'm a landscape architect in Yarmouth. With me tonight is Amy Bell, another landscape architect from my office, Seth Sprague, representing the Sprague Corporation, and John Green, the property manager for the Sprague Corporation. And as you know, we are on for two agenda items tonight, and we requested the last workshop meeting that we had with the planning board that we treat the issue of the boardwalk as a separate item because we feel that it is a standalone project and one that really is not connected to the family subdivision, which we'll be talking about as the next agenda item. And I believe the planning board agreed with that request at our last workshop meeting. So we are before you tonight for a resource protection permit application to construct a combination boardwalk and wooden walkway on a section of the Sprague Corporation property. Just to give you a sense of where we are relative to the siting, since I know some of you probably have not been out here, this is the causeway right here out to Richmond Island, and the boardwalk itself is on what is now known as Lot 9, and we'll see this later on this evening. It's in a part of the property that is not generally exposed to public use, unless public are there by permission of the landowner. It's a very private area, and it's really designed to provide access for the members of the Sprague family to get down to a small, very private beach just before the causeway. What it does do is require that we come before the planning board for the resource protection permit application. We've gone through a number of studies locating where the best location would be to put the combination boardwalk and walkway and upland access point. And there's a number of considerations relative to permitting, relative to family considerations, relative to visibility, floodplains, and so forth. Which led us to locate the boardwalk in its present location. We did go out on several occasions with woodland alternatives. Josh Reut was the wetland biologist that we worked with on this. And in laying out the best location, we were guided by a desire to minimize the effect of the construction or the installation of the boardwalk on the natural environment. We do have some photographs, which I'll pass around to you just to give you a sense of what it's looked like back in February. It's a lot chillier day when we went out there to photograph it. But you'll see pictures of the foredune here, the ocean over here, the back dune, and where the cars would be parked. off on the backside here. The boardwalk is roughly going through the areas that people are standing on in the photograph here. And you'll see the point where someone is standing right here is where the boardwalk would be going over the dunes and then onto the beach. These are rather generic photographs, but I think they're typical of the area that we're going to be affecting. As I said, there were a number of criteria that we looked at in citing it. First of all, we were told in our conversations with DEP that Amy will go over in a minute, that the least amount of vegetation that we can disturb within this area, the better our application will have when we go before the DEP. As you know, there's a lot of deer out here. There were a number of deer trails that wound their way from the upland area over here and the backside of the dunes. And one of the things that we discovered, it'd be possible to locate the boardwalk in such an area that has already been established as a trail by the deer and minimize the amount of clearing and vegetation removal. And that's the game plan. We went out with GPS units. We located the position on the face of the earth. We flagged those out. If you go out there today, you can probably pick up the exact location where it's going to be located. We know within probably a yard or so of the location of the walkway. That's not to say there won't be some adjustments made in the field, but the intent here was to minimize vegetation removal. We also tried to pick locations where we'd have to do the minimum amount of earthwork. In fact, I don't believe there's going to be much earthwork at all in putting the boardwalk in place. Another consideration that we had was the type of system that we're going to be using to get people from Fern Trail, which is the existing woods road that's this point right here, over to the beach, Strawberry Beach. We looked at a number of different systems. The helical screw was one idea that we had looked at. If you recall from our discussions earlier on last year on Dominicus Crossing, we had investigated this as a possible way to bring people safely and efficiently across a wetland area. We also looked at another system that we're actually going to be using in this situation, which is equivalent to a dock system. It's made by Great Northern Docks and essentially drives galvanized steel posts into the ground in this place between 2 and 4 feet. Through the muck of the wetlands down to the sand and gravel base. The posts are then capped off in a prefabricated wooden walkway system, a float, is installed on top of these steel posts. The posts then are capped off for safety purposes, and then the next system is attached onto that. It's a fairly efficient way to put a boardwalk in our comparison. The amount of impact that would be generated between this system and the system using the helical piers, we felt that this was the one that gave us the least amount of impact and was the most efficient and probably the most time efficient in getting the boardwalk in place. We're estimating the total construction time will be between 7 and 10 days to start to finish to bring the boardwalk from Fern Trail over to Strawberry Beach. The total amount of the project is roughly 330 feet, linear feet of elevated boardwalk, 4 feet wide from this point right here over to this point, crossing the freshwater marsh that you saw in the photograph. And we're averaging about 2 feet above the surface of the marsh. The boards themselves will be spaced probably with a wider than normal spacing just to allow as much sunlight as possible to penetrate down to the surface below the boardwalk. Again, one of the considerations towards wildlife habitat is that we don't shade any more than we have to on the marsh environment. There's also another component that you see in this illustration right here, this wooden walkway. Once we get across the elevated portion, this is the area that floods periodically. We will be going into the areas behind the fore dune, and we'll be putting this wooden walkway. This is a flexible walkway system. You've probably seen them when you've gone out to state parks. Essentially takes 2x8 planking with a hole that is bored through the long face of the plank, then a plastic-coated wire is inserted through that, and the boards themselves are separated by washers. The board block that would be placed in that configuration has the ability to be flexible as it goes over the sand dunes. We're also intending to take that system up over the foredune. The beauty of the system is that it can be rolled up and stored on the backside of the foredune during the winter months. We've also mentioned in our application that if the grades out here are too steep to accommodate the wooden walkway as we're shown here, we also may want to have the option, we do want to have the option to put in a more formal set of stairs, but these would also be removable, so they would be taken out during the late fall, winter, and early spring months and stored again in a protected area on the back side of the foredune. We have had Willett Alternatives out there, as I said, who has done an analysis of the property relative to wetlands. We don't feel there's any major impacts on the wetland environment. It does minimize filling. In fact, there's really no filling at all, save the 2-inch diameter steel posts that are driven into the ground. There is a certain amount of upland disturbance adjacent to the wetland, simply taking wood chips and putting them in this location as we're showing on the site plan. We did meet with the Conservation Commission on February 12th, as we noted in our memo to you of February 27th, and we don't believe there's any ongoing concerns that the Conservation Commission had. The only comment was that because we do have to go before the DEP, that they want to make sure that we have those permits at hand before we come back to the, before we start construction. I'm going to ask Amy Bell to report the conversations that they had when they met with Don Hollowell at DEP.
Good evening. As Terry mentioned, we met with DEP on February 12th. John Green and John Steinert from the Sprague Corporation were with me. We reviewed construction methods and permitting. The DEP is going to look at this in three components: the elevated boardwalk crossing the freshwater wetland will require a Tier 1 permit. The flexible board wooden walkway and the back dune area will require a permit by rule. And the temporary or seasonal wooden walkway won't require a permit because they don't regulate structures that are in place less than 7 months. So we also looked at the construction methods, as Terry mentioned, the Hilco Pier and the dock system, and it was our impression that they were looking more favorable towards the dock system because of the lesser amount of impact on the wetland itself. Let's see, the other, I'm trying to think of those other major concerns. They seem to agree with our basic location. And they seem to be fine with it. I don't know if there's any other comments.
We are asking for a couple of waivers that are normally part of the application requirement. We first of all are requesting a waiver of the requirement for a 1-foot contour in the area. We do have 2-foot contours, as you'll see, for the entire 1,500 acres of Sprague Holdings, and the information that we have developed from that has been used in the layout and the development of the plans. We certainly feel that the information that we're dealing with is sufficient for the type of use, given the fact that there is no grade changes that are contemplated. Secondly, we're requesting a waiver of the requirement of a high-intensity soil survey prepared by a soil scientist. Again, we had a great deal of work done by Woodlawn Alternatives looking at the type of plant material and the underlying soils that are out there. And again, we feel that there's going to be no disturbance, there's no erosion issues, no runoff issues that have to be contended with here. And there's also a waiver request for a stormwater runoff plan. Again, we don't feel we're going to be affecting the flow of stormwater resulting from the construction of the boardwalk. So with this, I would like to turn it back over to the chair for any questions that you may have.
At this point, I think probably our most appropriate step would be to look at completeness, and if we do have some questions on completeness, we'll forward those to you, Mr. Dewan. Yes, Mr. Parkhurst?
I'm ready to make a motion.
Okay. Please do.
Motion for the board to consider, be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application for the Sprague Corporation for a resource protection permit to construct a boardwalk located between Fern Trail and Strawberry Beach be deemed complete.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Is there any discussion? Mm-hmm. Hearing none, board members in favor of approval of the motion, please raise your right hand. The application is deemed complete. At this point in time, I think now if we have any questions or want to start going into the specifics of how things are being done or have questions for the applicant, we can proceed. Do any board members have any items which they'd like to put on the table? Yes, Ms. Masterton.
I'm just curious, how did the family get to the beach without the benefit of the boardwalk? And did they walk on water?
microphone.
I'm Seth Sprague. The current means of access to the beach has been for a number of years through the backyard of the Hansen House, which is somewhat further down the beach, and it's created a bit of a problem having the access so near that house. And we thought that we would do two things by creating the boardwalk, is we'd solve that problem, and we'd also create a lovely walk across the marsh to the beach.
Somebody brought up the question of whether or not you could park a car on Fern Trail. I presume, this being such a large area, the Sprague Estate, that some people would want to drive down Fern Trail. Is there a place where a car could be pulled off the road and parked?
There is some room for a few cars along the side of the road, but what we're